that everybody here can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast. Your hosts, James Gable and Brandon Thompson, are here to bring you enlightenment to the topic of communication.
Good evening, James.
Good evening, Brandon.
It's a big topic that we're going to discuss today, which is conflict management / resolution, because who has never had a conflict with anybody?
Nobody has ever had a conflict.
That is a conflicting statement. That statement aggravated me more than it needed to.
It did aggravate you. It really did.
I
did not mean for that.
And I'm normally okay with like double negatives, but that one I was not okay with. So there you go. All right, start us off, James.
Yeah, so I've got a quote from Kenneth Kaye, and it says this: if we manage conflict constructively, we harness its energy for creativity and development. And that's why today we wanted to discuss conflict management and conflict resolution as two separate topics, not to be confused with each other. Management is about navigating at a personal level.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to talk about those interactions that you might have across the bar,
mm-hmm.
interactions I might have with some coworkers or anyone would have in a work situation or really any situation personally with them.
So the management seems like the way you're going to conduct yourself to get to the resolution.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yep. But it's also about being in that particular moment as mm-hmm. well, too. And then the second one is conflict resolution.
Mm. So the whole point of all this.
The whole point of it is to come to a resolution. But the take we're going to take today, which you can apply in other different circumstances, is to help coworkers or people that you know resolve their conflicts together.
Yeah.
I think bring them together and help them resolve it. We got some steps for you today.
Yeah. One of the main things is that this is much more of a work environment as opposed to a relationship environment. Because everybody knows that to solve your relationship problems, all you have to do is say yes, dear, and everything's fine.
Yeah. We were going to have a relationships podcast, and that's the only two words that we had.
Was yes, dear.
Yes, dear. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? We could hit episode 400 and still be changing people's lives with that.
With yes, dear. That was actually one of the scoutmasters that I grew up with. So he says, as a young boy, you learn yes, sir. And then as like an adult male, you learn yes, dear. And both of those two things are freaking done and mad. Steve Kendall was a wise man. Don't know if he stole that from somewhere, but if he didn't, Steve Kendall's a wise man. All right. So continue on, James. Back on the topic at hand.
So back on the topic, we're going to first dive into conflict management. Now, conflict management on those interpersonal levels, we are going to engage all of our best negotiating techniques that we learned through all of our earlier episodes of The Uncommon Communicator.
Based on what book?
That would be Never Split the Difference.
By who?
Chris Voss.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. And what are some of those conflict management things that we're trying to be working with here today?
So what I've broken down to is, and this is trademarked by The Uncommon Communicator.
Is this like a James Gable original?
This is, I'm going to give credit to The Uncommon Communicator. You can have credit for all the money we're going to make on this.
Woo!
But this is what I find works for me is the slim approach.
Mm-hmm.
And by slim, it's slow it down, mm-hmm. listen. We're going to apply our labels and we're going to refresh on those as we talk through them.
Wait, but that was two L's.
And mirrors. Yeah, so the L is squared. Yeah, it's a mathematical.
Oh, it's like a legit mathematical equation where it's like a capital S, a capital L, squared, correct. Little I in parentheses,
yeah.
And then a M. And it's almost like a license plate.
You will find these in the show notes. So you can utilize them. Even though I'm going to trademark it, it is yours for you to use free, all of our listeners today.
Yeah. So you can see that in the, there's a math equation here, guys.
That is
communication and math.
This is going to be in the show notes for everybody. So starting first with, as you know, is my very favorite tool to use.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the late night FM DJ voice.
Yeah, there's actually I got a story. So we were I was at 72nd and Sheridan, the Starbucks off of 72nd and Sheridan. This is during quarantine, so all the lobbies were closed and everything was going on. And I had a partner on lunch, so he went outside, and I didn't really want to relock the door because I was going to have to let him in and out as he would come in and out or whatever. So I left the door unlocked, and a homeless gentleman actually like came into the store when like you know this is locked down COVID, so you're not allowed to have anybody in the store. So the second somebody, not us, walked in the store, like everybody like freaked out and started shouting or whatever. And the guy's like, da, 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 da. Like, you know, like both sides are getting it. I was like, brr. And I was like, what do you want? Not necessarily in like a late night DJ voice, but it was definitely like cut through the, like there was, everybody was like out of 10. And I like came in with a late night DJ voice out of 5 as opposed to 10. It was like,
still a lower level.
Still a lower level, right? Now, and you slowed it down. I was like, what do you want? Right? Just, you just like, you make eye contact, you make that connection, you slow the whole situation down. So it's not a bunch of people yelling one way. This other dude yelling one way. It was a, what do you want? Anyway, that's my.
Well, all right. So you make a, every situation is going to be a little bit different. You got to apply different tactics. But what I heard you using is something that you've got to use as well, too. If there's two people going at it, you're going to not go in and say, come on, guys, let's listen. You do have to come in to stop the situation.
Right. Yeah.
And that's taking that kind of command. So what you did is you kind of silenced them for a minute. And then from there, you can calm down. So that's a great tool to add to that. Because we're at the point where we've got to slow it down, quiet mm-hmm. it down. Right. Mm-hmm. So I like to go into that FM, you know, late night DJ voice, mm-hmm. really slow it down. Talks. The more you talk slow, the more they're going to slow down their emotions mm-hmm. and really let those emotions start to calm down. Mm-hmm.
You have to become more of a sponge as opposed to like a brick wall.
That's correct. Yeah, or two bricks smashed together.
Yeah, I was like, two bricks smashed together causes more conflict than a brick hitting a sponge wall, because those exist.
So in slowing it down, sometimes when there is a volatile situation, you do have to separate. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's good. Some people who I've found to be, they're more emotionally intelligent, but still not handling their emotions very well. Does mm-hmm. that make sense?
Like, oh, no, I'm
messing with you. They know themselves and say, look, I got to walk away for a minute.
Yep.
I respect that. That's to me being emotionally intelligent. And that person, you need to let them. You're like, no, hold on. That is not the time. They know they got to go calm down and come back. But here's the key. If they come back and say, oh, I'm good. I'm all feel better. Is that real?
It's not actually fine. No, that's the, yeah, no, you can't solve. So look, I can understand that things can get heated in the moment. It's fine. And it's important to not throw like gasoline on the fire. Like sometimes you need to kind of like poke the bear and like see where things go. Cause you know, you just need to listen and like let them get it out. Right. So sometimes you got to poke the balloon and have the balloon explode on you. That's fine. That can be a thing that you need to do. Other times you need to like, you know, not just let the balloon go away for a minute and then it'll kind of come back all shriveled up after a little bit of being out in the air. And then you can pop it. It doesn't make as big of a noise, but like it still gets heard. It still gets listened to and stuff like that.
I like it. Analogies.
I have my moments.
Well done, Brandon.
But yeah, it's, I mean, look, but you can't, the whole point of what we're saying today, and that goes back to the UC moment, which was the quote by Kenneth Kaye, is that like, you have to manage conflict. You can't ignore it, right? When you ignore conflict, magically conflict doesn't go away when it gets ignored.
It does not. And so that's important. Like when they separate and they come back and they really aren't good, you do have to address it. But in looking at, like right now we're talking, how do we manage this current situation with that we've got going on? Next step is listening.
Yeah. And it's important to, on so especially if it's you, right? So if you were in a management position and you have to manage somebody and it's you and said person having a conflict, as a management or as said person in management condition, you have to really like unbiasedly listen. You have like, you got to take your filters away for a minute and you just have to listen, right? And if you were not the person in the management, if it's two people having conflict and neither of them in a management position and you are the third party management position, it's the same thing. You have to listen to both sides. I don't care if you like Timmy more than you like Johnny, and Timmy could be right more than Johnny is, but like you got to at least listen to Johnny and, you know, throw the little bias thing out that you like Timmy more.
Well, and that's sometimes people just want to be heard.
Yeah.
And that's if there's conflict, and that could be towards you as a leader as well, too. You know that there's a little bit of animosity or something. Mm-hmm. You've got to get to that point where you want to listen to what they're going to say. And when sometimes just expressing it, we might be done managing that conflict right there. They're going to say those words out loud and they're like, yeah, you know what? That really was stupid. I've had a guy tell me that before. He goes, I'm sorry, I was being stupid. Mm-hmm. But he was so bound up in his own thoughts that he never expressed them, that he couldn't get past that point until he expressed them in his words.
No, yeah, that's it. And that's just, it's important to just sometimes listen, right? Because sometimes it's not the nail. Sometimes you just need people to sit down and talk. For those of you that haven't seen, go Google It's Not the Nail. Quality video. But yeah, it's a, listening is important. Like, that's, again, it's just like having a conversation with somebody else, right? You can't talk to somebody without listening to their responses, and you can't solve a conflict without listening to their responses. Otherwise, then you're kind of just sitting there and you're just sitting spinning in the same circle going around and around. And it's, again, like I said, it's also important to listen to both sides in this conflict, because I'm never wrong and you're never wrong. But magically, if we have a conflict, we can't both not be ever wrong. See, now you want to talk about stupid. Like,
see, that bugs you too.
Yeah, I did.
Well, and that is true. But as the manager, as a leader, you want to use your active listening techniques, and you're right, be impartial in that as mm-hmm. well too. And the other thing is to really listen to listen, not to speak.
Yeah.
You don't want to be thinking about that next thing. If you're thinking about what you're going to say next to them, then you're not listening to what they're saying.
Mm-hmm.
So slow it down, listen. The next thing is we're going to also put in our best two negotiation techniques, which is labels and mirrors. Mm-hmm. Labels, now you really like labels, right?
No, they're incredibly effective. Because when somebody gets caught up in their own emotions, right, half the time they're not going to vocalize exactly what's going on, right? They're caught up in their emotions and they're just going to let it fly. So labels get into the root of the problem, and actually having them vocalize what's wrong or what's going on and to see their perspective is important, right? So using the it seems, it feels like. So that way they continue to express how they're feeling, what's going through their mind and stuff like that.
And you're confirming it because, yes, like you just said, sometimes they're letting it fly. You could repeat their words back to them. So it seems like this, and they're like, oh, that's not what I meant. And you repeated their exact words back mm-hmm. to them. It helps them understand. And then you're coming to an understanding of exactly what their meaning was.
Yes.
So.
No, yeah. So that's it. So labels are really my favorite tool just to kind of get to the root of the problem, just in general, right? To get to the root of how somebody's feeling is what I use labels for.
Now, sometimes people don't want to talk, and that's where I really like using mirrors.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, you know, repeating the last word or idea back to them. Usually you're going to get more detail out of them. You're going to get their thoughts. They're going to release that floodgate of stuff just because they want to make sure that you understand them.
Yeah.
You're saying, you know, you're just finishing that last word.
You're going to make them feel comfortable enough to talk to you.
And we don't talk about this in our negotiations as much, but I do think it's important in these situations to mirror body language. Mm-hmm. If you're looking and trying to connect with that person, it's not just the words to draw words out, because now we're talking about a connection. So you want to mirror their body language, you know, whatever they're doing mm-hmm. to make sure that you're making that connection.
When they pick their right nostril, you make sure to pick your left nostril.
I wouldn't recommend picking your own nose.
Oh, not that kind Okay.
Different.
I don't even get credit for like switching nostrils like a mirror would. So that way you're perfectly mirroring them. My goodness.
You would get extra credit for that.
Okay.
Yeah. And cool. They would think you're weird.
Look, again, effective. That's almost an icebreaker.
That's actually not a bad idea. I hate to say it. That's not a bad idea. So that's the concept we have for managing conflict, which is the SLIM method. Slow it down, listen, labels, and mirrors.
Or in mathematical terms, SL squared I in parentheses M.
Yeah.
Lowercase right. I for, but yeah.
Trademarked. The uncommon communicator.
He's so excited to say that.
I am. I'm going to trademark that. I don't know what that means. Does it cost money? Anyways.
Moving on. No, it costs money if somebody else uses it.
Bingo. Then we owe Chris Voss a lot of money.
Well, no, because we give him credit.
Every time, too.
Yeah, but we give him credit. We did. Yeah. Right.
Okay, we're good to go.
We're clear.
Whew. All right, so moving on to conflict resolution. And this one is a little more complicated because it involves you working with two different personalities.
Mm-hmm.
And it does take a little bit of practice, like we talk about in our negotiation techniques. These are things that you're going to be uncomfortable with doing for the first time.
Yeah.
If you're not skilled at it, you haven't ran into these situations before, then you're not going to be ready for them. So I encourage everybody to do a little role play, do a little bit of practice with it. Mm-hmm. And then best of all, as you experience these in your life and you apply these, you're going to get better at them, because everybody is going to have conflict. And all of these things, the SLIM method, and also these kind of five keys to this resolution, I have used, and each time they're a little bit different, but you get in the practice of it where you're comfortable doing it, because you also need to make them comfortable mm-hmm. as well too. And you've got to bring that if you're going to come in there to help them resolve it. So the biggest thing is, well, there's no problem. What do you mean?
Yeah.
We're fine.
Fine is never fine. Don't ignore it. Just number one. And this is something that Brandon struggles with quite a bit, especially at work. Because I like to just handle things on my own or whatever, right? Like if it happens, it's fine. I'll deal with it later or something like that, right? It's just like, it's whatever. Just get out of my hair and get out of my way and I'll solve the problem, right? I had my current manager is coming in here and just changing things that I do not like to be changed. And I had to sit down and talk with about it, about a couple of things. There's still more to talk about. But I had to take 15 minutes before I went and sat down and had a conversation with her. Put my head on Tammy's shoulder and I was like, Tammy, I'm going to have to go talk with her. And she's like, yeah, you're going to have to go put your big boy pants on and talk about it and talk to her because you can't ignore it, right?
Yeah, so yeah, exactly. So one of the things really is you're going to do your team a favor if you address those conflicts because these things do fester. You've got to nip them because it becomes toxic and really bad for everybody. And you've got a new manager, so you guys are learning how to communicate with each other. Mm-hmm. All of those things are going to take those kind of negotiation skills, but they're little conflicts, basically.
They are.
So you've got to deal with them. But so we're going to talk about five keys. I wanted to make sure we were clearly communicating that.
What are we talking about?
Five keys to resolution, which is don't ignore it. We're going to clarify what the issue is. We'll go into a little detail with that. Bring involved parties together. So we've got to talk this out. We're going to identify a solution, and then we want to monitor it. So we want to talk about five keys as part of this conflict resolution. Now, we just talked about don't ignore it, and that is one of those things that I think it starts a negotiation. Mm-hmm. You have to first identify that it's there. I've been a victim of this, or not a victim. I've been a perpetrator.
There you go.
Yeah.
James has committed the crime. Brandon's committed the crime.
We've all committed the crime.
Anytime you have ever been passive aggressive, you have committed this crime.
Yeah. And so passive aggressive, you're just trying to pass it off and not worry about ever dealing with that conflict, right?
Yep.
And hoping, and I think this is the case with some people that are passive aggressive, they want to see if you're going to bite too.
Oh, yeah.
And if you've got the skills to negotiate that, you have to identify that passive aggressiveness. But some people are just bent that way.
They just want to play a game.
Yeah.
That's a
game.
Passive aggressive is a game. And it can be fun to play for a little bit, but you never get to the end of the... You never get to a resolution
Passive aggressiveness?
Yeah. You never get... Yeah, anyway. You get the point.
So passive aggressive fits right in there with that don't ignore the conflict.
Yeah, because it does... That is literally ignore the conflict. It's something that cannot be done. So put your big boy pants on, and go approach the problem, right? Don't ignore it.
And it does take, it takes a lot of guts to do that.
It does. No, it's not easy. I told you, I put my head on Tammy's shoulder and I was like, Tammy, I'm breathing deep, breathing out the whole thing. And it took me like 15 minutes to buck up Buttercup and go do it. Like it's not pleasant. It's like ripping off a Band-Aid, right?
This is not easy. And
no.
No, that's a great point on ripping off the Band-Aid. But the other thing that I have found, because I'm like a couple days older than you, right? At least
by once or twice,
a decade or two, is
hey, man, I'm catching up. I just got there this past week. You are catching up.
Hey, congrats on the birthday.
Thank you.
One of the things that I've found is those things, looking back now at my life, there's times where I've ignored those conflicts and I've regretted it because they never got better.
Mm-hmm.
So regret probably isn't the right word, but now I've learned like, okay, there's a problem here. Let's do it. Let's do it now. Like I'm prepared now to confront that because I know that it's only going to fester and get worse.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing is really to clarify what the issue is. That goes back to what we talked about in managing our conflict is let's talk it out. Sometimes just those words coming out, what's in their head isn't what comes out their mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And when they connect those two dots, they're saying, it's not really what I meant. And then they realize that they were capturing emotions and weren't verbalizing them and creating a conflict.
Well, yeah, and it seems dumb, but the conflict tends not to be the other person exactly, right? It tends to be something that the other person is doing and or not doing, but it's not the person themselves. And a lot of what ends up happening when you ignore a conflict or whatever, or you just sort of, you kind of get caught up in it, is that you project that conflict onto the person as opposed to it's not the person, but it's an action that the person is doing and or not doing. You know, like, it's not the person identically, right? Like, I don't look at levels of conflict that Brandon has had and not dealt with properly. Our delivery drivers are supposed to pick up some boxes and some trays at the end of the night. They still have a, I don't know how, but they have a struggle doing this. So to deal with the problem, because I just never saw them, right? We don't get into a room because they're nighttime delivery drivers. So to deal with the problem, Brandon decided to lay everything out directly in their pathway so that they would either A, step on it, or B, have to pick it up and put it on the truck. And I left a note saying, hey, this is, you know, annoying. Maybe if you guys could pick those up on a regular basis, that would be great. Again, that's that passive aggressive.
You left a note?
Oh, I did. I was like, gosh, those are all in the way. That's kind of annoying.
Definitely.
Yeah, 110% passive aggressive. And needless to say, they took pictures and sent it to their boss, which then got it all the way back to my boss's boss. So my boss had to have a sit-down conversation and be like, hey, buddy, so these aren't the people you're having the conflict with. You have a problem with the people not picking it up. And I was like, yes, I'm having a problem with the people not picking up the stuff that they were supposed to pick up. So again, I like our delivery driver, Jacques. He's a nice guy, actually. However, I had a massive problem with Jacques just not picking up what he was supposed to pick up. But I projected that problem onto Jacques as opposed to it being the problem itself.
Well, and when we're talking about clarifying the issue, it's about biases as well, too, right? Because mm-hmm. that's almost the other side of what you're talking about. Clearly, the issue, it's not the nail. And that seems to be the theme for today in understanding conflict, is it's not about the nail. But in this case, there are biases that we place. And when we start verbalizing them, I think at that point, they're out in the open and we understand them a little bit better.
Yeah, because you sit down and you're like, oh, how hard is it to pick up a box? It's not very hard. And then you kind of just spirals down as you keep going. Like, oh, no, this idiot just can't pick up a box. He must be stupid. It must be that. And it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse and worse. That's
quite the rabbit hole.
I'm telling you, man. Like, you got to understand
it's
that
just it's just a box, man.
It's in my way, and it's still.
Moving on. So we're going to clarify the issue. The next step is, and you need to be, in clarifying that issue, you got to be impartial in that, too. You can't be, if you are helping basically negotiate a situation, you've got to remain impartial to gather all that information. Next step is you've got to get them together. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to tell you right now, I have made this mistake more than once, and is to not remain that guy, the go-between. You think, I'm going to solve it. I'll separate them. You talk to me, and then I'll figure it out. That is a huge mistake that this uncommon communicator has made before. You don't want to do that, but you want to bring them together to talk it out. Sometimes they can just getting them together, they can work it out. Mm-hmm. But then from there, we're going to talk about a couple of skills that really help us get them to a common understanding.
Bring them together and it humanizes them and tends to calm people down.
I think getting two people in the room, the key is what you're talking about. It humanizes, but also sometimes what's brought out, like we create those biases. Somebody does something, maybe they're not working hard enough. They're really bugging the heck out of you, right? Mm-hmm. And when you bring them in and then they somehow amazingly mention the story that, you know what, their mom has been in the hospital for the last week and he has not slept. He's been going there every night. That's that human part of the story of that conflict that we mm-hmm. don't often get to until we have that conversation.
Okay, it's not just your side. There's another side to it, right?
It creates a little bit of empathy.
Empathy, yeah. That's it. These are other humans and other humans have other things going on. You're not the only person on the planet and everybody has their own issues. So it's important to take a second to be like, okay, hey, I wonder if Jimmy's dad's doing okay. And this, you know, like I said, there's just something's going on, right? Like you just sit down and you're like, okay, something might be going on and I'm not the only person here.
So the key is to get them together and really come to a common understanding of the problem. Because mm-hmm. sometimes there's not even a commonality of that. So you get to understand that there's a common problem. And then from there, you can identify a solution. How can we work this together? Well, you know what? I really don't like how you do this. I don't like how you do that. They can figure out a way that they can work together and or do it differently. It's mm-hmm. about getting those conversations. So the next one is really identify a solution. And that's facilitating through that dialogue that we were already talking about and bringing them together. Mm-hmm. So bring them together, identify the solution. And really, once you get those solutions, you go on your merry way and you're done. That's not necessarily the case. The key here is to really monitor and to follow up on that conflict. Sometimes you can see it or feel it. You know that everybody's working fine now. And I've seen that, like people that you thought were unconsolable before, mm-hmm. like sometimes they become the best friends. ever had, because they've had that conflict. They've came to a mutual understanding. And in reality, what they kind of butted heads together with was the very thing that they had in common with each other. Mm-hmm. And they build that kind of bond together. So that's how some of those things come to a complete resolution, and people can look past those things. Those are kind of the golden eggs that come with it. But a lot of times, I don't want to say a lot of times, at times, those things continue to fester because it wasn't fully vetted out. Maybe they weren't emotionally intelligent enough to really care, you know, have that full conversation. Mm-hmm. So you have to monitor it and make sure that you're observing it from time to time.
Because dare we say history is doomed to repeat itself.
And it will. And if you have not talked it out, and if you have not come to a solution, then it is going to repeat itself. So when that happens and you see it kind of rearing its ugly head and you realize that this never came to a resolution, what do?
Go back to number one, man.
Let's start over.
I was like, start back at number one.
Because you're still a conflict. You're not at a partially resolved conflict.
No. There's no such thing as a partially resolved conflict. You can maybe get to a point where things are like workable, and that's fine, right? Like where it's, okay, I no longer hate Johnny's guts. I can come to work and I can let him breathe the same air that I breathe. And that's a partial resolution. But like, that's also, you need these two people to still work together, or you need something to still get accomplished in a functional way.
But let's be clear. Sometimes a resolution, especially in a work situation, is to not have two people work together.
Yeah.
That's an acceptable resolution as mm-hmm. well too, because for whatever reason, we all have our own personalities and we just don't get along with everybody. Brandon does.
Well, everybody. I you get to deal with people for your entire life and it doesn't change. So shockingly, dealing with people, it's a good idea to come up with a way to deal with people.
Yeah, and that's exactly, you're going to have conflict. Is mm-hmm. that what you're telling me?
I'm telling you, you're going to have conflict, so you should find a way to deal with said conflict. And ignoring said conflict and being passive aggressive about said conflict is not a functional way to deal with. Like, put on your big boy pants and your adult size jeans and just go do it.
So that kind of brings us to a point of recap, which I think we had some really good information today on conflict management, conflict resolution. Specifically for conflict management, we talked about the SLIM method, mm-hmm. which is what?
Which is SL squared. Lowercase I, parentheses, M.
You're making this, it doesn't look as complicated when you read it, but it's slow it down, listen, labels, and mirrors. And then especially on that conflict resolution, there's five keys that when I researched that there's probably 20 different keys that you can use, but these are the top five, and use them in this order and you're going to be successful in resolving your conflicts, because it gets you right back to step one, right? So you're going to keep doing that until you can get that conflict resolved.
And if there is one of these steps that I will say that you just need to remember for all time and always, is don't ignore the conflict. As it turns out, conflict does not resolve itself.
That's exactly it. So, and just to then, okay, let's recap on the top five keys. Don't ignore it. Clarify what the issue is. Bring them parties together. Get them talking. Mm-hmm. Find a solution. All of this seems simple. What I like about this is none of this is deep enough that we're going to have to go do an episode on all of these. These are simple enough. And then that fifth one just keeps that loop going. Mm-hmm. Monitor it. Make sure it's going the way that you want it to go.
Which then also leads us to the UC moment of the week, the day, the evening, the time is, if we manage conflict constructively, we harness its energy for creativity and development. Kenneth Kaye. That's also K spelled K-A-Y-E.
Thanks for clearing that up.
Well, that's actually, okay, this brings up a story. Sorry. Story time. I had a teacher that told me one time that three vowels never like go together, right? They're like, you know, you never get three vowels in a row. Tell that to Kenneth K. Anyway, once again, UC moment. If we manage conflict constructively, we harness its energy for creativity and development.
And that is all we've got for today.
See you. Bye.